This meeting, the RTM will come to order. It's Wednesday, August 10th, 7:30 p.m. Will the clerk please take the roll?
Okay, Mr. Moderator. Representative Adams?
Here.
Bailey?
Here.
Baker?
Here.
Burrell? Bauer?
Here.
Burgos?
Here.
Casper?
Here.
Sini?
Here.
Connolly?
Here.
Dean Shinbrot? Evans? Frickman? Garcia? Gilli? Hubbard? Longino? Laughlin?
Here.
Marr?
Here.
Marley? Massett?
Here.
McCabe?
Here.
McDermott?
Here.
Merritt? Nault? Nugent?
Here.
Aubrey?
Here.
Parker?
Here.
Pasqualini?
Here.
Quinn?
Here.
Slicker Hassan?
Here.
Steinford?
Here.
Irma Streeter?
Here.
Jim Streeter?
Here.
Swindell?
Here.
Wagner? Watrous?
Here.
Wells?
Here.
Williams? Wilson?
Here.
And Newsom?
28.
We have 28 members present. I declare a quorum. Can you all please stand for a moment of silence? Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Next on the agenda is approval of the minutes for the July 13th RTM meeting.
Second. That was Wilson and
who seconded?
Adams.
Thank
you.
Motion to approve the meeting minutes from July 13th has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Representative Laughlin. Is there any other discussion? Seeing none, we'll vote on the meeting minutes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Abstain.
21 in favor.
Representative, I'm abstaining.
Two abstentions. Streeter, Irma Streeter.
Both Streeters.
Oh, two Streeters, so that's three.
Both Streeters. Is there anybody else abstaining? That motion carries to 25-0, three abstentions. Next on our agenda is citizens' petitions. This is the portion of the RTM agenda where the RTM welcomes comments from citizens. Each presentation should be limited to 10 minutes or less, and citizens should, if possible, submit written comments. Presentation should be limited to matters pertinent to Groton. The moderator, members through the moderator, shall ask questions only in order to clarify the speaker's presentation. Responses may be given to the moderator and or by the town manager. Citizens should make their presentation from the lectern and state their name and address for the record. And because we have a lot of things to cover tonight, I'm going to limit the time to 5 minutes per speaker. First person we have tonight, Craig Kohler.
Good evening. My name is Craig Kohler. I live at 263 Brook Street in Groton. I'm here tonight to urge the RTM membership to vote in favor of the school facilities initiative so it can be put through to a referendum vote by the taxpayers of Groton this November. I was co-chairman of the School Facilities Initiative Task Force, and I was also a member of the Phase Two School Building Committee. So needless to say, I've been at this for quite some time. The task force was formed in January of 2013, almost 3.5 years ago. It was comprised of 19 stakeholders with a variety of perspectives. We had members from the Board of Education, school administrators, town council members, teachers, citizens at large like myself, and members of the RTM. We were also aided by our consultants from Malone and McBroom. The task force spent countless hours at meetings, field trips, and briefings with our consultants, learning about the condition of our town schools, the demographic trends of our student population, various school configurations, numerous possible school locations, racial imbalance laws, and state reimbursement rates. We incorporated recommendations from the Educational Vision for the Groton Public Schools, which was established in May of 2014 by a stakeholder workshop, which was convened by Superintendent Grenier. On May 28th of 2015, we conducted a public meeting and held informal breakout discussions with attendees to answer their questions and gather feedback. The summer of 2015, we had the Center for Research and Public Policy conduct an opinion survey of Groton residents, which indicated their support for the project once they became more informed of the situation facing our schools. About a year ago, we met with you, the RTM, the Town Council, and Board of Education together to present our findings and answer your questions. I believe our task force has completed a most thorough job vetting every aspect of this project and obtaining as much feedback and input from the public and elected officials that we could. Now is the time to let the process continue and let the voters decide what the future of the Groton Public Schools and Groton will be. After all the time, energy, and effort that has been spent to date, it is now time to put this proposal to referendum. We cannot afford to keep putting off addressing the needs of our schools any longer. I urge you to please vote to send this proposal to referendum tonight, and I thank you for your time and service to the town.
Next up is Wes Greenleaf.
Wes Greenleaf, 120 Brook Street in Groton, of course. Lifetime resident of Groton. Superintendent Grenier asked me to come here tonight and just discuss some of the issues with the schools because I've had some experience, 33 years with the responsibility of the facilities. I think I've been on every committee from the very beginning in 1989 that has led to where we are right now. I feel very strongly that this plan should be presented to the voters. And of course, that can't be done unless a majority of the people in this room agree that it should go that way. Difference between maintenance versus capital improvements. Mr. Grenier asked me to just discuss that briefly. The schools in my time, I can say with modesty, were about well maintained because the Board of Education funded maintenance very well. Sometime in the 80s, maybe not so well, but after that, very, very good budgets. However, there's a big difference between maintenance and capital improvement. Capital improvement is the responsibility of the Town Council and the RTM. The Board of Education doesn't vote on capital improvements. Just because, you know, people have the idea that somehow, because our buildings weren't maintained right somehow, that they need to be improved now, have to be replaced or refurbished. That's not really the crux of what's going on here. Also, it's not that the town council somehow ignored capital improvements to our schools. In 1996, I think it was December, the town council faced with it's kind of a dilemma, aging schools, this is 20 years ago, decided we really don't want to put a lot of money into capital improvement until we know what we're dealing with. They formed the Blue Ribbon Committee. They hired an architectural firm. The Blue Ribbon Committee didn't recommend a lot of new buildings. However, the architect that we dealt with at that time was convinced that a lot of our buildings just weren't worth saving. They weren't worth putting the money into. Capital is very, very expensive. A lot of the capital improvements that our buildings require right now exceed the limit money-wise that would require a referendum. We would have to go to referendum on things like sprinkler systems for these buildings. Or, you know, if you combine this together, for sure. So no matter what, we're looking at referendums. These aren't small projects that you can simply do with a regular year-to-year budget. Getting ahead of myself here. Let's see, conditions at Pleasant Valley, Claude Chester, and S.B. Butler. These are the three elementaries that we're proposing close. We feel, for good reason, that they should close. Every committee, except the Brewerman Committee, has agreed that that is the case. We've had a number of architects involved in this. We've spent hundreds of thousands of dollars with the consultants over the years. Castle Booz, JCJ, McKissick, and now Malone and McBroom. All come to the same conclusion. A lot of these buildings just aren't worth saving. Why aren't they worth saving? Just some of the things, and this would go on a long, long time, and I know that you get a look at the capital improvement budget each year, and these are all listed, and I think they're still listed in the capital budget. Each year we update it, we put together an estimate of what it would cost to do the improvements to these buildings to make them fully functional, at least as buildings. Electric issues in all three of these buildings are serious. The buildings were designed in the early 50s, and one of them in the late 40s, they were designed for film strip projectors and lighting. We have computers now. We have all kinds of additional devices in these buildings, air conditioners in the windows. They put a tremendous draw on the electrical use. And over the years, as we added air conditioners or as we added computers, we simply added more sub-panels into the building. And at this point, you've got so many sub-panels and so many circuits, it's almost impossible to figure out what breaker is tripped when a breaker trips. And they're all on the verge of being overloaded, period, all three of them. What needs to be done to a build, the entire electric system has to be stripped out and replaced. That's a given. That has to happen. We can't go on the way that we're doing it. It's as simple as that. Lead-based paint in all three buildings. Lead in the classrooms, lead in the hallways, lead on the outside side of the buildings. When lead paint gets old, it delaminates from the lowest level out. And whenever you have a delaminated piece of lead paint, it means that even though we've repainted with non-lead since 1979, it means that you're exposing lead paint. The requirements the state puts us under not to deal with this, you cannot abrade it. You basically have got to cordon off a room, draw negative air pressure to get the lead-based paint off. You can't prevent those lower levels from peeling off. It happens. So there's a huge issue with that, and it requires a lot of repainting, and it requires a lot of careful removal of chip paint. But you can't get to the core of it unless you remove all that paint. It's almost an impossible task. Take a building that's 30,000 square feet, roughly the size of 25 typical houses. Asbestos is still an issue. We removed all of the friable asbestos, easily crumbable asbestos that could mix with the air and cause the hit in 5 minutes.
Keep going.
Oh, okay. That was all removed in the 80s and the early 90s. However, non-friable asbestos remains in most of these buildings, especially S.B. Butler. Another issue that we found out about more recently, when we removed the friable asbestos from the buildings, a lot of it was in the crawl spaces that have dirt underneath them. Pipes were covered with asbestos, the asbestos got damaged, the asbestos fell to the floor. The state required in the 80s and 90s when we did this, just to remove the first 2 inches of soil without testing. Now we're required to test. If we do anything in these crawl spaces, we have got to test. Our experience with demoing Unit 5 at Fitch High School is that those dirt crawl spaces have friable asbestos in them. Our maintenance workers have got to go into those spaces on a regular basis to maintain piping and electrical. That's an issue. It's an issue at Pleasant Valley and at Claude Chester. See, handicapped accessibility. None of these buildings, these three buildings, are fully accessible to handicap. Doors have got to be changed. Hallways have got to be altered. We have to have, for instance, Claude Chester has two exits on the newer wing, which was built in 1958, that have steps down. We don't have ramps. So there's a lot. We haven't, it's another one of those issues. You know, if it was just, good point, if it was just handicapped access, we would have done this years ago. But it's accumulation of all these things, old buildings that need serious work. Life safety is the most important. These are your fire code issues. We don't have areas of refuge in the stairs at Claude Chester. We don't have sprinkler systems. We have a fire alarm system that if you're running a music program in a classroom, you can't hear the fire alarm go off in the hall. Modern buildings require fire alarms in every single space. This room has them all around the corners. We don't have those in the classrooms. We don't have sprinkler systems. Now, the first thing people say, well, we're not required to do it. We're grandfathered in. That's true. Sprinklers are important. They were instituted in buildings a long, long time ago because they make the building safe. Safer. Some buildings don't have rescue windows. And these are, you know, I could go on and I'm over my 5 minutes. 5 minutes Celsius, right?
Mr. Greenleaf, how long were you the director of buildings and grounds for the Groton Public School System?
Since 1979.
He has a lot of history. That's why I'm letting him go over, because there's a lot. He's got so much information, and I think it's valuable.
But it's important because this information doesn't get, it gets out piecemeal. Security is an issue at all three schools. I will not go into the details. That wouldn't be proper for me to do here. Just to know that a building built in the 1950s with the current problems we have, especially this year, they need work. We've done a lot. We've done a number of things to make them as secure as possible. They need a lot more work to bring them up to standards of modern buildings. Infrastructure, heating, ventilating, air conditioning. None of these three schools have decent ventilation. They're not equipped with central air conditioning. We have put air conditioners in all the classrooms, which is a great idea. It's a cheap way of doing a cheap fix. However, when you put an air conditioner in, you're recirculating the air in the classroom. You can't open a window because the room will get too hot. So now you've got 30 kids in a classroom, sometimes more, sometimes less, reusing that air hour after hour after hour. And the reason we have heating, ventilating, and air conditioning systems in our new schools and all new construction, including this, is you bring fresh air in. You don't have the ventilation that you need. Room air conditioners should be seen only as a stopgap method. Things like worn-out doors, kitchens installed, Claude Chester kitchen. The dishwasher is built in, stainless steel, built just for this tiny little kitchen. And to replace that, I remember some years ago, some $40,000 to replace it. We have a machinist on the crew for good reason, because you need a machinist with an old school district, that actually built a whole new impeller because he's a very talented guy, and saved a dishwasher that would normally have to be thrown out because they stopped making parts for it in the late 1960s. So that, you know, that's the type of thing that Sam puts up with on a daily basis. I got to commend Sam. He's made it all the way to 65. I didn't make it. Portable classrooms, and this is another big deal. Between S.B. Butler and Claude Chester, we have 7 portable classrooms, and I don't know why we call them portable. That's some sort of a name that the state gave them. They're not portable in any way. They're buildings. They're a lot like a little house. There's 7 of them that were built in 1971 as a temporary measure to house students during the baby boom. All 7, as far as I know, are still in use. They are temporary. They're built as a temporary building. We had a catastrophic failure of one of these at S.B. Butler, where a snow load caused part of the roof to collapse. We ended up, no kids were in it, nobody was injured, and that's the luck of Groton. Things like Eastern Point, when the ceiling collapsed, nobody was injured, thank God. We ended up putting an entire new roof structure on it. We couldn't do without the portable classroom. Those buildings have got to be replaced. They need to be replaced as quickly as possible with permanent structures. Portable classrooms have a built-in problem with security, because obviously they're detached from the main building, without going into details. you can imagine. That's a huge issue. We've taken measures that we won't discuss here, but they're not ideal for security in a school when kids have to go outside to get to another building. Also have a construction trailer converted into three small classrooms at the Pleasant Valley School. Actually, we bought that trailer when the Northeast school was completed from the construction contractor to use on a temporary basis, still in use. Westside Middle School in Cutler, I won't go into real detail, they're a lot newer than the three elementaries, and they're a lot closer to being salvageable, even though they're on the borderline too. But just real quick, at Westside Middle School, again, HVAC systems, heating, ventilating, and air conditioning systems, it's only partially air conditioned. Part of the building is heated by steam. Actually, the entire building's heated by steam, but the newer part installed 25 years ago is converted to hot water. So more problems with asbestos at Westside Middle School with a dirt crawl space, same as Colchester and Pleasant Valley. Cutler Middle School, newest school of the five that we're talking about to you tonight about HVAC issues. There is no air conditioning there. We have a problem with ventilation there. Doesn't meet modern standards. It's not a sprinkled building. It has problems with handicapped accessibility that are very, very difficult to solve because you have to have a space next to a classroom door wide enough for a wheelchair to approach. And because of the structure of the building, we can't do that. It requires structural changes in three quarters of the classrooms in the building. Life safety codes, again, similar, needs fire sprinklers. The fire alarm system should be replaced as soon as possible. Has a great deal of non-friable asbestos. The ceiling tiles in all the classrooms except the newer additions from 1970 are glued to the ceiling with non-friable asbestos glue, which means if a tile comes down, you have a roof leak, you have a potential problem with asbestos. Plus, if you want to do any work at all above the ceiling, you can't touch that stuff. We're allowed with trained personnel to work on up to 3 square feet. You can't even work on a big enough section of it to get above the ceiling to service the utilities up there. That's an issue.
Wes, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to.
Yeah, I know. Okay,
let me
wrap it up here. Cost estimates, we're looking at $27 million at the elementaries. That estimate's based on 2002 figures that have been escalated, and at the middle school is roughly $28 million. One more point, if I could just make
it.
Say we spend the $60 million fixing everything that's wrong with these buildings. The problem we still face is that they're built for education in the 1950s. We do not have OT-PT rooms designed for that, occupational therapy and physical therapy. We don't have music rooms designed for music rooms. We don't have art rooms. We don't have special education rooms. Our kitchens are absolutely overwhelmed. The only kitchens even close to being decent is at Pleasant Valley. S.B. Butler is just been stuck together in what amounts to a closet. Cafeterias don't exist at Pleasant Valley and Colchester. We actually eat in the gymnasium, which cuts into gym time, but it is also an unsanitary condition. Conference space, on and on. These spaces in our new buildings are designed for those purposes specifically. We use classrooms for that purpose. And I'll just end it there.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for the time.
Well, thank you. I let Wes kind of go on because regardless of what happens with our voting for the referendum, these issues are going to have to be addressed, and I want you guys to be informed. Next up, Jane Dauphiné.
Jane Dauphiné, I will be very brief. We want to say that we understand that this is a big project, a major initiative for Groton. And we respect your work because you've clearly understood that, as demonstrated by the very thorough and seriousness with which you've considered this. It's a big, complicated, important, and transformational project for Groton that will benefit not just our students and their families, but all of us because of the economic development impact it will have. It will improve the attractiveness for Groton for prospective home buyers and employers that we need so badly. Other towns recognize this and they are investing in their schools, and we think we need to too. For this reason, because we, like you, recognize this is a huge project, have worked deliberately to bring this to voters in the November election of a presidential year when we know turnout will be the highest. That's how we want voters and taxpayers to be able to participate in this decision, and we hope you feel the same way and approve this to go to referendum. Thank you.
Lenny Winkler.
Good evening, distinguished members of the RTM. For the record, my name is Lenny Winkler. I'm a lifelong resident of Groton. I have served on the Groton Board of Education from 1983 to 1988. I'm currently the co-chair of the PAC Groton 2020 Schools. I'm a commissioner for the State Freedom of Information Commission, serve as president of the board of directors for the Center for Hospice Care, where we are in the process of raising funds to build a hospice house for all the residents of Eastern Connecticut. I am here tonight for two reasons. First of all, to read you a brief letter from Mayor Bruce Flax, who could not be with us. And it reads, I understand you are voting tonight on whether to send the 2020 school plan through to referendum this fall. I am unable to be there as I am vacationing in Vermont, but wanted the RTM to know I fully support the plan. Many will speak of the virtues of the plan and what it means to the future of education in this town. Please understand it is about more than that. The quality of our schools has a direct correlation to the future of the town and the economic development of the town. This plan is as important to economic development as the additional budget money given to planning for economic development this current budget year. With the future influx of workers for Electric Boat, people will be moving to this area. One of the first things they will look at is the quality of our schools and the school system. We will be in competition with East Lyme, Waterford, and Stonington, and all of the other shoreline communities. How do we compare? There was an article in the day yesterday about the amount of repairs three East Lyme elementary schools need. Do you think East Lyme will do nothing? This town needs to fix the schools. Please vote to send this plan to referendum and give the people of Groton the opportunity to make an informed decision. Thank you, Mayor Flax. Secondly, on my own, I would just like to echo the sentiments that were made by the speakers before me. This vote is very crucial tonight. I respectfully request that you support the question of allowing the citizens of Groton to vote on this proposal in November. Thank you.
Thank you. Mike Grainer.
Mike Grainer. For the first time, 496 Noank Road in Mystic, Connecticut. I've been a resident for about a week. But I'm here actually on a more serious note. I just wanted to frame this vote tonight On behalf of the Board of Education, because there's a very serious pledge that the board made in, as Craig pointed out, in May of 2014, the stakeholder group got together and put a plan together, and about two or three weeks later, we received a letter from the State Board of Education saying that one of the schools, Clodchester, was out of racial balance, and that we had 4 or 5 months to put a plan together. So we actually took the plan. We knew when we were developing the plan that it was primarily aimed at improving the educational quality of all of our students. But we also knew that it would address some of the racial imbalance issues. So I brought that plan. Chairman Watson, Kim Watson, and I brought the plan to the State Board of Education and submitted it, and they accepted it, and with the understanding that there would be a referendum, they thought it sounded like a great plan and wished us well in the referendum vote. But I do want to say that there's a kind of a municipal promise that was made. If it goes to the voters and is rejected by the voters, I would certainly report to the State Board of Education, and we would have to develop another plan. But I would urge you to vote to have this go to the voters, because from my perspective, a municipality was told, you've got an issue you need to deal with, put a plan together. A large group of people put a plan together. Actually, it was really a culmination of 3.5 years of work, put a plan together. And I submitted that plan on behalf of the municipality. So for me, there's a bit of integrity here, and I would strongly urge you to vote in favor of the ordinance going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Grenier. Roseanne Katowski.
Roseanne Katowski, 24 Ann Avenue, Mystic, Connecticut. Now for the other side. First, as I did last month, I would like to thank the RTM members who supported the taxpayers during the recent budget deliberations. I, along with many, many others, appreciate that the RTM reduced the 2017 tax increase. Thank you. Also, I'd like to restate my comments from last month regarding the new economic reality that we are facing. Groton cannot provide all the services it has always delivered. We must align spending with revenue. We must ensure government provides its core services while living within its means. And we must budget based not on what we wish we had, but on the dollars we actually have to spend. Spending plans based on earlier budgets make assumptions that keep the status quo. And when the money runs short, decisions must be made on the basis of what there is to spend, not which programs deserve to be funded. I understand that the Phase 3 committee believes that this project deserves to be funded, but is it really a good project that is worthy of being sent to the voters? I do not think so. When spending the taxpayers' hard-earned dollars, elected officials should always spend no more than you make, borrow only what you can afford to pay back. If it's not broke, don't fix it. And we should have all the government we need, but only the government we need. This project, if passed, will be paid for with borrowed money, and all our taxes will increase. Properly managing tax revenues is hard, and raising taxes is easy. I am hoping that the RTM will make the hard, difficult choice and not raise taxes and not send the Phase 3 project to referendum. This project should not go to referendum for many reasons. The first reason, of course, is that we don't have the money. We have to borrow the money and raise taxes to pay for it. No matter how the Phase 3 project is packaged and presented, there is no savings when taxes go up. I also understand that some RTM representatives do not want to deny the voters the opportunity to vote on the Phase 3 project. However, projects should go to referendum because there is a need for something. Elected officials should use referendum to ask the voters to fund a project that they support, believe in, and think is a good project. The voters elected the RTM representatives to make the difficult decisions regarding how our hard-earned tax dollars will be spent. Sending the Phase 3 project to referendum when there is no support for it in the community simply shifts the RTM responsibility to the voters. Many people in the community believe that this project is unnecessary and do not support it. How do I know this? Last fall, I knocked on over 700 doors and walked down 66 streets in all parts of Groton. Throughout 3 or 4 months while campaigning, I met one person that was thinking about supporting this project in this version. If the Board of Education was truly interested and concerned in correcting racial imbalance in Groton, it could be done tomorrow by making Northeast Academy and Claude Chester, as well as Butler and Kalnowski, sister schools. Combine both student populations, have one school for grades K through 2 and the other for grades 3 through 5. Problem solved forever without spending hundreds of millions of dollars. For years, I have brought this idea to countless public forums. The resistance I encountered from the Phase 3 committee last summer regarding sister schools is that parents will not have their children bused. This criticism, I believe, is baseless, considering 20% of the Groton student population is transported daily outside Groton public schools by choice. Sister schools are not new for Groton. In fact, Groton had sister schools for many, many years. Freeman Hathaway and Mystic Academy had one student population, as well as Colonel Ledger and Groton Heights, keeping neighborhoods and siblings together. It worked quite well. This would not cost one penny. It does not require a $184 million school referendum and hundreds of thousands of dollars to be spent on consultants year after year. Also, the Board of Education, after too many redistricts to count and spending millions of taxpayer dollars on portables at each of the middle schools, has created a workable middle school scenario. Now we must live with it. It works. We do not need new schools in order to have a good education system. There is no information available that equates shiny new buildings with an increase in the quality of education. So let's end the never-ending building committees and consultants fees. It's time to live with what we have and make it work. Considering all I have outlined here tonight, it is my hope that the RTM will once again be good stewards of the public's trust and hard-earned taxpayer dollars and will not send the Phase 3 project to referendum. Thank you.
Kevin Trail.
Good evening, everyone. Kevin Trejo, 536 Shenacosset Road. I'm not going to repeat everything that everybody else has said, except one, I will ask you to please send this to the vote on for a referendum. Every phase that I've been in this town since 89 has always gone to referendum, even if the taxpayers voted it down. So I think, first, we should let that happen. Two, this is going to cost the town estimated, hopefully, $84 million if it's passed and everything goes through. If we don't do it, it's been brought to you before. The numbers from 2012 from McKissick and everything else was about $55 million just to bring things up to code. Wes mentioned that before. Add the other 5 years, come 2017 escalation cost, it will cost estimated $64,000 at that point. Then figure going into CIPs over the years, knocking some out back and forth, these numbers are going to start growing. Then 84 sounds a lot better than spending 64, 70, 75 as you're going 10 years down the line, 15 years down the line. To me, it really doesn't make sense, 84, to escalating numbers as we go along. I remember I started getting involved with the Phase 1 back in about 2002, for those who remember, when we were looking to go into, they were looking to fix buildings. If they did nothing, the estimated cost was almost $52 million. State reimbursement on F-52 was only $6 million. I don't have the exact numbers today on different things for repair, but you really don't get money back from the state just to bring things up to maintenance, up to code, because that's something that's basically should have been done as you go along. Asbestos removal and things like that give you a little bit higher. But 84 compared to numbers that can start going up to 64, 70, 70, depending on the years, is a no-brainer. So all I'm asking really is just let it go to referendum. And I think the taxpayers will tell us what's best for us at the schools. Thank you.
That's the last person we have signed up. Is there anybody else who would like to speak at this time? All right. Reception of communications. Representatives Wagner, Nault, Garcia, Dean, Shimbrot, and Hubbard, and Frickman emailed and said they would not be here tonight. Report of the town manager.
Thank you. Hopefully all of you had a chance to pick up the newsletter off to the side. Financial statement, fund balance as of June 30th, 2016. These are unaudited numbers. Was approximately $9.1 million, which equates to 7.3% of the FYE 16 general fund adopted budget amount. General contingency budget for FYE 17 was appropriated at $425,000. Approved transfers as of July 31st, 2016, in the amount of $7,000 to help fund the workings of the Charter Revision Committee was approved by the council, leaving a balance of $418,000. And then capital reserve fund balance as of June 30th, once again, unaudited, is estimated to be $712,000. Couple things I just want to highlight. I'm glad to report that the library and staff have found a way to fund most of the Sunday hours that were to be eliminated as a result of budget reductions. There's an article in your newsletter giving a little bit of background on that initiative and a group, a newly formed group called the Power of Together, which is going to be providing the library with $5,800 in funding so that most of those hours can be reinstated in the coming year. Sounds like a great organization, and possibly, you know, some of us in the room may want to participate in the future. We've also just been notified that once again the town has received the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting from the Government Finance Officers Association for its CAFR, or the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, for FYE 15. Fun event coming up. Hopefully some of you would be able to attend the third annual Groton Town Police versus Groton City Police Department softball game. Will be held on Saturday, August 20th at 4:30 p.m. at Washington Park. I won't go through the details, but I do want to just note for you on page 5, there's a fairly lengthy article giving an update as to where we are with the Client First initiative. That was the IT project that both the council and the RTM cut this year with the general sense that, well, we can fund it next year. So we are proceeding at staff level, doing the staff work, working with our consultants to get in a position to very shortly issue a request for proposal. While we don't have the funding to hire anybody at this point, we hope to be in a position come next late winter and early spring, so that when you're deliberating on next year's budget, we'll be ready to go. Attachment 8, I know there's renewed interest in economic development activities. So there's a update from our Office of Planning and Development Services, basically letting us know what's been going on in the community, and that's through June. Just a couple other things I just want to note that you may be interested in. There is an event on the 19th of August, and it's really, in part, it's part of the year-long sub-century celebration. It's the Air and Sea Celebration, which will be held over at the Mystic Jet Center, North Hangar on Tower Avenue. Some of you may have gone to, it's a very different event, but it's kind of the same venue. Some of you may have gone to the Doolittle Raiders event around 7-8 years ago. It will be very similar to that. Should be a wonderful event over at the airport. Also, the planning department is in the process of undertaking or having a survey done. They've asked us to notify the council, the RTM, and anybody else that will listen to please take a look at what's in your packet. There will be a random survey that will be done over the next month or so. You may get a phone call, or you may want to talk it up with friends and neighbors in case they get a phone call from the company that's doing this survey. And this is to get a better handle on economic development needs and wants and desires throughout the community. And that was all funded as part of a year and a half ago's budget. And then lastly, another fun event on September 4th. This is one of the remaining. There are a couple more events that will be happening in the next month and a half, but this is one of the last ones with respect to the sub-century celebration. There's going to be a sub-box derby over at Washington Park on September 4th from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. It looks to be a very exciting event. I can remember when I first came to town, there actually were soapbox derbies on Flanders Road, and I think also on in the city also. I think Jim Streeter has a funny story about those that he used to race, but I won't go there. Also, I just want to note, and please, I think you'd all be interested, this year we have published copies of the mini budget summary for the adopted budget. I know all of you spend a lot of time going through the budget in April, and then really the next time you see the budget is the following April. So this is a summary report. It doesn't have all the detail sheets in it, but it will maybe something that you want to look at certainly before next April, but probably over the next couple months, just so that you can see what the various changes were to the various town, Board of Ed, subdivision budgets. And that's all I have.
Thank you very much. And that covers the economic development, too, I assume. Yeah. Are there any questions for the town manager? Representative Conley.
I'll be brief because I know our main focus here tonight is the education discussion. But can you explain the increase in the sewer bills that many of the town taxpayers received?
It's probably not as well as I should be able to, but that was a planned increase that was in the budget. So I actually haven't received any complaints. So if you have some, if you could get them to me, and we can follow up with folks.
I will get those to you. I've heard several folks, it is only $22 increased every quarter, but it does add up. And several folks had gotten to me and spoken to me about it, that the increase along with the increase in their taxes and some of the fire districts, which are all understandable due to the nature of the fire district business and the needs for appropriate protection. But when those three got together for some of our folks on a fixed income, it was a decision in July about things like groceries and your basic necessities. I recall from our discussions that we did request that greater percentage of the fund balance was used to make this budget meet. I do not recall any discussions about an increase in the mill rate for the sewer taxes alone. So I will get you those complaints so you can follow up with those folks.
Great.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions for the town manager? Seeing none, we'll move on. Next item is report of the superintendent of schools. Dr. Grenier, did you have anything else you want to say? Nope. All right. Are there any liaison reports?
Mike did a great job for what I was going to share.
Very good. Next is committee reports. So, to alleviate some confusion, I want to explain what my plan is for tonight. As you know, we had two committees take a look at the school referendum project, Finance Committee and Education. Rather than have them both come up, read it, put it on the floor, et cetera, what I'd like to do is have each committee come up, read their meeting minutes. We'll vote on approval of the meeting minutes if there's any questions. And we'll have both committees do that. What I would ask is save your questions, unless they refer to the meeting minutes themselves for those two meetings. Please hold those questions, because once we're done with the committee reports, I'll put the number on the floor, the referral. We'll get a second, and then we'll open the floor up and have discussion. That way I will read the referral one time, and it'll just be less confusing. Sound good? All right. First up, Finance, Chairman Quinn.
Good evening, everyone. The Finance Committee met last Wednesday, August 3rd. The meeting was called to order at 7:05 p.m. Attendees: Chairperson Quinn, Representative Connolly, Marr, Marley, Nault, Pasqualini, Moderator Scott Newsom, Town Manager Mark Goldfinger, Finance Director Cindy Landry, Superintendent Michael Grenier, Board of Ed members Dr. Ackerman, Christina Fitzgerald. Absent, Representative Gillies. Motion to approve discussion on the adoption of ordinance on the school facility initiative was made by Rep. Pasqualini and seconded by Marr. Superintendent Grenier gave an overview on what the committee proposed for the Groton schools. We would have one middle school on the town-owned Merritt property. We would then convert the two middle schools into like-new elementary schools. When completed, we would have one high school, one middle school, and six elementary schools. The cost of this project would be $184,500,000, and this cost assumes that we would receive grant funds from the state of Connecticut. The grant funds would be received because Claude Chester will most likely be out of racial balance. Superintendent Grenier felt confident that we would receive the grant to address this issue. Grant money would be 80% of the funding of the upgrade of the current middle schools to convert to elementary schools. Town Manager Mark Goldfinger indicated that we would have to receive a waiver from the state for the cost of the square footage. It is currently $450 per square, and we would have to increase to $107 per square, which is the current cost of this project. The question to Mark Goldfinger was asked what will happen to the schools that no longer will be needed. He thought that Claude Chester should definitely be a keeper because of its location. He saw no reason for keeping Butler or Pleasant Valley and suggested maybe housing slash and or parks. He also discussed the Merritt property that was purchased with state funds and was to be used for recreational purposes, that we could maybe do a land swap with another property that the town owns. Rep. Pasqualini asked the committee, what are we doing? Do we think we can pass this with the economy the way it is? The mill rate will go up too much and doesn't take into account the mill rate going up year after year with the budgets. After this discussion was completed, a vote was taken to recommend to the RTM on whether this should be a referendum for the voters in November. The vote was 1 approved, 3 rejected, and 2 abstained. The meeting was adjourned.
Move the minutes. Are you moving the minutes?
I move the minutes.
The minutes have been moved and seconded. for the August 3rd Finance Committee meeting. Is there any discussion on the minutes? Seeing none, we'll vote. All those in favor of accepting the minutes, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. Community Development, Chairman Conley. Education, Chairman Nugent.
Good evening. Can you hear me? This is the minutes of the RTM Education Committee meeting that was held on Tuesday, August 2nd, 2016 at the Groton Senior Center. Attendees from the RTM committee were Kathy Nugent, chairperson, Thomas Frickman, Jim Laughlin, Jackie Massett, Lori Watrous, Alicia Bauer, and Jim Evans. Absent, Archie Swindle, who informed the chair he would be absent. Others, Bruce McDermott, RTM member, Dr. Michael Grenier, superintendent of schools, Cindy Landry, director of finance, town of Groton, Connecticut. The chairperson Nugent called the meeting to order at 6:08 p.m. Seven committee members were present. A quorum was declared. One committee member, Representative Massett, had to leave early, but a quorum was still maintained. The chairperson thanked all for attending. Unfinished business, none. New business. Chair Nugent opened the meeting by saying that the purpose of the meeting was to discuss and then vote on a recommendation to the full RTM for referral number 2016-0169, adoption of ordinance on school facilities initiative. She asked if everyone on the committee had read the ordinance, and everyone replied they had done so. Chair Nugent said she believed all present were familiar with the proposed school facilities plan. Chair Nugent said she would like to start by saying that this ordinance will be reviewed by both the RTM's Education Committee and Finance Committee. She further stated that our main charge is to review the educational soundness of this plan. The Finance Committee will be looking at the finances. She said, however, she understands that it can be difficult to separate the two, so she expected there will be overlap between the two committees, even as both have a different main emphasis. With that introduction, Chair Nugent asked Dr. Grenier if he would like to make an opening statement, and then she would open the floor to questions and comments. Dr. Grenier opened his remarks by referencing an editorial in the New London Day, which noted that Groton's schools were deteriorating. Dr. Grenier said the way to counter deterioration is to invest in our schools. Is the educational plan sound? He gave the example of coming from a meeting recently about a grade with 44 children at one of the elementary schools slated to close. Options are two classes of 22 each, or three classes at 14 each and hiring a teacher. Moving to fewer elementary schools means he can balance classes and teachers better for equitable class sizes. Dr. Grenier pointed out that our older elementary schools were built in the 1950s and 60s. Back then, they did not have special education students in public schools. So the schools and classrooms were not built to accommodate those students, for example, allowing for wheelchairs. Older schools have libraries. Now we need media centers. Dr. Grenier spoke about the 432 students who have opted out of Groton Public Schools. Why? Parents want to have choice. For example, here in Groton, Catherine Kolnalski, our own intermagnet school, is a popular choice. 100 children chose it this year, with another 91 who applied. Note, intermagnet means in district. The two new elementary schools to be built at Westside and Cutler would be intermagnet schools. Westside will be a STEM magnet school, Cutler a performing arts magnet school. With modern facilities and more programs in town, hopefully fewer kids would choose to attend school outside of town. The racial imbalance problem would go away, and with it, the need for redistricting. We can control by lottery for magnet programs to achieve racial balance. Dr. Grenier made these additional points. The middle school plan would consolidate the two middle schools and build a new school on the Merritt property next to the high school. creating an IB International Baccalaureate Campus for grades 6 through 12. Currently, the IB program in Groton is only offered in grades 11 and 12. In addition to the middle school IB program, the STEM, Performing Arts, Dual Language components of the new elementary schools would continue when the students progress into middle school. The two middle schools are not racially out of balance currently, but combining the students at an earlier age townwide would be a good idea and could create opportunities for children at the middle school to take some classes at the high school and for the two schools to share teachers. Dr. Grenier explained the renovation as new concept. You have to start by building on the same footprint as the old school, and it has to be built to last at least 30 years. You basically get a new school and a 10% bonus on your reimbursement. The plan would eliminate portable classrooms. School construction is not getting any cheaper. If we put it off, the investment will cost more later. We also gain a walkable elementary school in the city. Questions and comments. Representative Jim Evans said people in his area are not for the plan due to the budget this year. He said that he and his kids and grandkids went to Norwich Free Academy, which was built before the Civil War. The school was always kept up to speed with maintenance. He feels Groton has done an atrocious maintenance of its schools. If we redo the middle schools, they should last longer than 30 years with proper maintenance. Representative Lori Watrist asked how the new schools would increase the educational value in addition to what Dr. Grenier has already said. Dr. Grenier replied that new facilities are attractive to parents and he wants to be competitive with other towns. But good schools are more than good facilities. He wants to have a STEM school with all the labs applicable, a performing arts school with the appropriate storage space. Representative Watrist stated that people she has talked to in her district are concerned about the cost. She likes the middle school next to the high school for the opportunities. She is concerned about entrance and exit to Fort Hill Road. Representative Alicia Bauer stated she likes the plan. She asked if there was a way to have some kind of initiative with Grasso Tech. For example, letting middle school students get a taste of the different fields they might pursue. Not everyone is going to college. Dr. Grenier said he liked that idea and would explore it further. Representative Jackie Massett talked about the lack of maintenance of the schools. CIPs are cut and cut, so the money isn't there for maintenance. She asked Dr. Grenier what kind of new high school New London was going to build. Is there a possibility of them building an IB school? Dr. Grenier replied that they may be starting a small IB program in a primary school, but he emphasized that it's not easy to be an IB school. You have to meet rigorous standards. Dr. Grenier elaborated that he would like to have reasonable facilities to provide a platform to put together competitive programs. State funding is drying up. Groton needs to be a more attractive alternative with rigorous programs. Representative Tom Frickman stated that he understands we have to spend money on the schools, but he doesn't support consolidation of the two middle schools and the cost of the plan. He feels that Plan B to renovate the schools would get more support. As for consolidated middle school, he was concerned that going from small to large would result in more discipline and attendance problems, less staff attention for students, and increased travel time. Dr. Grenier replied the task force looked at large schools in many different communities. He said that large schools have to be structured properly. He is proposing a house system with four teams each with a different focus, for example, performing arts, STEM, and dual languages. It's about engagement with the students. Representative Frickman replied that he has a child in Groton schools. He particularly likes Butler School and would hate to see it close. Can't we renovate that school and create it as another magnet school? Dr. Grenier replied, we can always renovate, but it's the oldest of the three schools and would be difficult to renovate on that same footprint. Representative Kathy Nugent said there was a lot she liked in this plan, but she did have some reservations. She agrees that we need to upgrade and modernize our school facilities and that just putting new roofs on old buildings is not a good solution. And she likes being able to create more intermagnet schools. But she also talked about her concern for one large middle school. She said she has talked with citizens in town who feel that for that age group, a smaller school is better, and who worried about more bullying at a bigger school. Dr. Grenier said that the new school would have three floors with a different grade on each floor, and reiterated the dividing up of the student body into smaller teams. Representative Nugent also expressed concern about the cost of the plan. She floated an alternative idea: do the needed maintenance to the two middle schools with an addition to replace the portable classrooms, close one of the three elementary schools, and renovate as new the other two. Dr. Grenier replied it would be difficult to build on the same footprint on those sites. He further said that the task force considered many alternatives. Representative Nugent said she was frustrated that the task force didn't at least cost out more options and present more choices for comparison. Representative Nugent asked Dr. Grenier if the application he submitted to the state at the end of June is just applicable to this plan, or could it apply to a modified plan? Dr. Grenier replied that basically it has to be this plan. Representative Jim Laughlin stated he was listening to plans that are dreams. We have 432 students being sent out of Groton. A lot of past decisions have put us in this position, like all delayed maintenance. Representative Laughlin asked, with state funding unreliable, with state funding unreliable, Groton could end up paying a higher percent of costs for out-of-town magnet school enrollments. Dr. Grenier agreed. Representative Laughlin said he keeps hearing about more and more specialization. Why specialize in the arts where there are few jobs, he asked. Dr. Grenier replied that everyone gets the same solid core curriculum: reading, writing, math, science, and social studies, and after that they can take specialties courses. It's important to keep the kids engaged. Representative Bruce McDermott said in West Mystic, where he lives, there is a lot of concern about the cost of the plan. There is a need to get information out to the people. Representative Bauer said if we don't put a plan out there, then every year that goes by, the cost goes up. Now interest rates are low. Representative Frickman says he has a child in Groton schools and can't support the plan. He elaborated that he did not support consolidation and was also concerned about the cost and the unknowns. Representative Nugent said she would vote yes. She said she couldn't fault the plan's educational soundness and is not sure any of her alternative scenarios would work or would be any more cost effective. Dr. Grenier expressed his hope that the full RTM would vote to send the proposal to referendum. Chair Nugent made a motion on referral number 2016-0169, adoption of ordinance on school facilities initiative, seconded by Representative Watrous. Prior to taking the vote, Chair Nugent clarified that a yes vote was in favor of passing the ordinance, which would send it to the voters in a referendum. A no vote is in opposition to passing the ordinance, and the ordinance would not go to a referendum. Results of the vote: in favor, Representative Jim Evans, Lori Watrous, Alicia Bauer, Jim Laughlin, Kathy Nugent. Opposed, Representative Thomas Frickman. Abstained, 0. The motion was approved 5-1. Motion to adjourn made by Representative Bauer, seconded by Representative Jim Evans. Motion passed unanimously. Meeting adjourned at 8:30 p.m. Respectfully submitted, Kathy Nugent, Chairperson, RTM Education Committee. Thank you.
Okay, move the minutes. Go ahead, move the minutes.
Oh, I make a motion to approve the minutes.
Second. Motion's been moved and seconded to approve the meeting minutes for the August 2nd Education Committee meeting. Is there any discussion on the meeting minutes? Seeing none, we'll vote on those minutes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries unanimously.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. You're all set. Thank you. RTM Rule 6.4.1.1 says in part that if the vote of a committee is not unanimous, the dissenting majority can give a minority report. And Representative Frickman requested that this be read into the meeting minutes as the minority report for the Education Committee.
Okay, so he said, I cannot support or send to referendum a plan that closes our neighborhood schools and consolidates them into larger elementary and middle schools. Research has shown that consolidated schools have lower attendance rates, increased behavioral problems, longer bus rides for our students, and lower test scores. Additionally, in larger schools, students have less instructional time and access with their teachers than they would in our neighborhood schools. As a veteran teacher and parent with a child in the district, I fail to see how this plan will benefit our children. I will not support closing our elementary schools, especially in the middle schools. Thomas Frickman. And we have that printed at the office.
Minority reports are not voted on, so it's just read into the record. So, all right. Recreation, Chairman Wilson.
No meeting, no minutes.
Public Safety, Chairman McDermott.
No meeting, no report.
Public Works, Chairman Dean Shinbrod's not here. Is there anybody from Public Works? Was there a meeting? No. Rules and Procedures, Chairman Massett. Very good. And then we'll get on with business at hand. I'd like to place a motion on the floor for $184,500,000 for referral 2016-0169, adoption of ordinance on school facilities initiative. Is there a second? Motion's been moved and seconded. I'll read the referral. Adoption of ordinance appropriating $184,500,000 for the design and construction of the Groton 2020 plan, consisting of a new consolidated middle school and conversion of the existing middle schools into renovated like-new elementary schools, and authorizing the issue of bonds and notes in the same amount to finance said appropriation. The rest of the referral, anybody at home who wants to look it up, can go to the website of the town of Groton, www.groton-ct.gov. A lot of information there, and one of the other things that you can do is you can find out on the left-hand side, there are links to the school project, and you can get all the information you want on this project. There's executive summaries that are nice and short for people with poor attention spans like me. And then you have others like the 240-page report that goes through everything from end to end. So I would ask that people, if they get the opportunity, go and look at that information. All right. Motion has been moved and seconded. Discussion. Representative Streeter.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. As many of you are aware, I've been involved in local politics and government for over 35 years here in Groton, and more recently been involved with the phase one of the school program, and then also I was on the task force for a short period of time. But throughout these years, I've learned that you listen to both sides. You listen to the pro and you listen to the cons. So far in this project, we pretty much have heard the pro side of it. Because of that, I'm going to vote in favor of sending this to the public for their vote. And the reason for that, it gives us a period of time to November to hear both sides. By hearing both sides, it will enable us and the voters to make an intelligent and an appropriate decision as far as this project is concerned. And I would respect and hope that other members of the RTM would consider the same. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Representative Conley.
Thank you. First, thank you, Mr. Moderator. First, I'd like to thank the superintendent and the town manager for providing an awful lot of information to this group and my committees that I served on over the last month, which have been of a help for me to make my decision. I do have a final question for the town clerk as to the costs of the referendum that the town would have to incur, or that your office would have to incur.
Okay, so I did, I got this question pre the meeting, so I got some information from the finance director and from the registrar of voters. So for my office is responsible for the explanatory text if the council asks to have it. We're not required to have explanatory text, but traditionally we do, and so I'm assuming we are. Now, depending on how elaborate the text will be, will depend on how much it will cost to print. And the last referendum we held, our explanatory text wasn't terribly elaborate, but it served very well for getting the information out. And we issued 19,458 pieces, and it was distributed through the day's circulation of the Mystic Times and the Groton Times, so it reached 7,256 Groton Times folks and 12,202 Mystic Times folks, and that cost the taxpayer $2,290 for the printing and distribution, which I think is quite reasonable. I also am responsible for printing legal ads of the entire ordinance, or a summary if the council approves. And that runs anywhere between $1,400 and $1,700 per opportunity. And I have to do it three times, so whether it passes or fails. So then the ordinance itself, the preparation of the ordinance, and through the beginning to the end, we have a bond council, and they gave an estimate. Let's see if I get a total on that. So $53,000 is about the estimate of what a total referendum would cost. And if it were to fail this evening, this vote, there are still costs that have been incurred. And I'm not sure how much that is, so I can't give you that estimate. I do know that the bonding attorneys and the town attorney's fees would be bundled into the ordinance if it passed at referendum. So we wouldn't have an extra fund, extra bill, But if it failed at a referendum, we'd have a bill to pay. Okay. So then you have an actual election, and Registrar of Voters Office sent two scenarios, a regular municipal election, so last year's, with all the different costs, was a total of $22,590. And this year, the estimate is $29,194 presidential. So there's your costs.
Thank you. As one of the reps for District 4, I've been talking to my neighbors. And the residents of Groton understand that this is a very serious decision to invest $184.5 million into the school district, a decision that requires careful thought and consideration. Over the last month, the RTM has held three meetings, one main meeting and two committee meetings, to answer many of the questions about this project, the benefits to students, the safety of students, the location of the school, and the cost. This investment will raise taxes substantially, about $575 to $600 a year for a house valued at about $300,000. Some residents of District 4 have already made up their minds. However, the majority of the residents of my district are still deciding and asking questions about whether they approve or disapprove this project. So I will vote yes to this project tonight to allow my constituents the time they need to ask more questions and to decide and evaluate this substantial investment.
Representative Obrey. Yes, ma'am.
Quick in. Sure.
Okay. My question is, the day recently made us all aware of the fact that there is a question on the location for the new school. And I think for the general public, that's going to have an impact on how comfortable they're going to feel to vote on this referendum. Personally, I think that on the educational side of things, you're going to have to get something out to make people feel a lot more comfortable with where the school might end up being. And it's my understanding that we have not started, I could be incorrect, with the state to get an okay to change the location. I beg your pardon? Perhaps we have.
Mr. Manager?
Well, just a couple of things. We have started. We started in October of 2014 in our discussions with the state. And I should note that, you know, we don't have a project if we can't build the middle school on the Merritt property. It's very specific that that's where the school should go. Whether or not we have a firm decision from the state by November, that remains to be seen. But we've had some significant progress with the state in the last month or so. We've offered up a number of different properties over this period of time. There's been some discussion back and forth about the worthiness of some of the properties. And I think it's fair to say, certainly for us, this is something we've never done before. And I think it would be fair to say for the state, they may have done this before, but they haven't done it a lot, and they don't like doing it. I mean, you know, it's kind of, you know, you bought the piece of property for open space and recreation purposes, and they don't want to be opening the floodgates, so to speak, with other towns coming in. I get that. But we are making some progress. We have offered up a piece of, more recently, a piece of property that they are looking at. It may or may not be the one they ultimately sign off on. We need to have control of that property when we want to build the school, not so much by November. We would love to have it, believe me. I would absolutely love, if this item goes forward, to be able to say well before October 8th that we're all set with the state. But as I noted last week in a conversation, do we really want to have the swap happen and then have the voters turn the referendum down? So it's kind of a little bit of a chicken and the egg, but I feel much better from the meeting that with the Finance Committee, because in the couple days after that, there was a flurry of activity with the state. And so I think we're making some progress. But, you know, that's a precondition. We don't have a project without that happening. We don't have a project if we can't get the waiver from the state for the $450 square foot. The diversity issue is we need to get that to be able to get 80% of one of the schools paid for. That may happen automatically, as the superintendent has noted on many occasions, because, you know, when the census is done in October of this year, he will know, not officially, but he'll know whether or not we have a diversity issue or not. But if we don't have a diversity issue, I think the argument can certainly be made in Hartford at the legislative level that Groton sometimes is in and sometimes is out, and it's always based on the most current year. So you could work 3 years on a plan and be out of balance, and then when you're ready to go forward, 1 year you're in balance. And I do think from the limited number of meetings I've had in Hartford, and I would certainly defer to the superintendent and others, I think they recognize that. I think there would be the ability to certainly make a good case that there's something unique happening in Groton. And, you know, some years we're out of balance, some years we're not. We're trying very hard to address the issue. So there's really kind of three preconditions. One, we may not need any special legislation for, because we may be out of sync or out of balance as of October 1st. But as I understand it, that doesn't become official until the following May, when it gets published in a state document. But with respect to the land, we are trying. And I do, I feel much better now than I did 2 or 3 weeks ago when we met with the Finance Committee.
Well, I am getting a little hot of hearing, so I might have missed the fact that in all the presentations that I've listened to, I've not ever heard anything mentioned about this situation with the land. And I think that that's going to be the feeling of a lot of people that are going to be deciding what they're going to do. I personally think it should go to referendum. I think the people of Groton should be telling us what they feel with something of this magnitude, how they're going to handle the impact of it. But I think there has to be more clarification. I think this was not brought forward in the manner that it should have. You know, to read the paper and go, what the? You know, wasn't really what you needed. So, as I say, I do think this needs to go to the people. I think it does need to happen. But when you have surprises, you lose a lot of people that are going to be confident in going forward with you. Thank you.
Representative McDermott.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. It's apparent we have some real conflict in the RTM with regard to the votes taken by the Education Committee and the Finance Committee. As a floor leader for the Republicans, I'd like to say and make clear that most of us are voting to send this to the people. Why are we doing that? Because we believe it's the most democratic thing that we can possibly do, given a project of this magnitude. But many of us have misgivings about the cost and the many moving parts. The voters really should not misconstrue our pretty much majority support for this project as support, blanket support for it. But we do feel, however, that we've just got to get a decision made and move forward. It's as simple as that. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Representative Swindell.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I've been following this at a little bit of a distance. I've had some issues that have kept me away from some of the RTM meetings, but I think the issue tonight, as many have stated, is whether or not to send this to the voters. And I personally am in favor of doing that. And I was wondering to myself, why do we have this kind of process? Why does the RTM have a vote on sending something to the voters so important to the town and its educational quality, its economic development, and all the rest of it? And the only reason I can think of to vote no on this, and this is just my thought, is that the plan is so egregiously bad, so poorly planned, so expensive, or so objectionable in some other way that you don't even want to take the chance of people approving something like this. I don't believe that's true on any of these counts of this plan. It's been thoroughly researched. It's been thoroughly planned for almost 4 years. Yes, it's expensive. We're catching up, and we're trying to remain competitive with the region's towns. But I won't, you know, I'm not going to make a case for voting for it or against it in the referendum. But I do think that, you know, we as the RTM should not impose ourselves between a plan like this and letting our constituents fully explore it in public forums, in public hearings, in, you know, conversation across the backyard fence. People need to understand what this means in terms of the future of Groton and what it will mean to their children and what it will mean to their pocketbook. And I think the only way to do that is to let it go to referendum and let the discussion proceed. Thank you.
Representative Pasqualini.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. My one question would be is, if it should go to the voters, we'd have the largest amount of taxpayers actually coming out to vote since it's a presidential election. Why wouldn't we have any survey questions on there to whether you're voting no due to cost, no due to the plan, no or yes to whatever those are? So that way, that would be an accurate, very accurate survey of all of the taxpayers that came out to vote. Would pretty much tell the town, not just a no or a yes, we don't know their reason why, because you're going to have to come back with another plan or another objective. And if it's price, then you know, you priced yourself out. They go with the plan, but they don't like the price. They like the plan, or they don't. And I think that would be better than trying to guess why they voted it down or the aftermath afterwards, or if they did vote it through. Thank you.
Is there any further discussion? Representative Bauer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think this should go to a referendum. I think the RTM is not, when it comes to something that involves this great deal of money and making a decision for the town, the RTM's place is to investigate it, to look at it, and then to send it to the voter for the voters to make a difference, for the voters to decide what they want. I think it's very important, personally, that the school system be the best it can, because good school systems are important to the growth of the town. I have sons who travel around in their business, and every town they go to live in, the first thing they ask for is schools. So to me, this is very important. And I think it's very important. And the RTM's purpose is to say, this is a plan that looks good. This is a plan that we've looked at. And we think you, the voter, should take a look and make your decision based on as much information as been presented as possible. Thank you.
Any further discussion? None? Going once. All right. We will move to a vote. I'm going to take a roll call vote on the amount of $184,500,000. I know. It's, wow. That'd make a difference, right? For referral 2016-0169.
Okay, so yes or no, please. Adams?
Yes.
Bailey?
No.
Baker?
Yes.
Bauer?
Yes.
Burgos?
Yes.
Casper?
Yes.
Sini?
No.
Connolly?
Yes.
Evans?
Yes.
Laughlin?
Yes.
Marr?
Yes.
Massett?
Yes.
McCabe?
Yes.
McDermott?
Yes.
Nugent? Aubrey?
Yes.
Parker?
No.
Pasqualini?
No.
Quinn?
Yes.
Sleeker Hersant?
Yes.
Steinford?
Yes.
Streeter Irma?
Yes.
Streeter James?
Yes.
Swindell?
Yes.
Watrous?
Yes.
Wells?
Yes.
Wilson?
Yes.
Newsom?
Yes.
24 in favor, 4 opposed, there's no abstentions, because there's no
Motion carries 24, 4 to 0. Next item, budget discussions. Are there any budget discussions? Seeing none. Other business. Representative Wilson.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I just wanted to say that as an individual member of the RTM, that my vote tonight did not necessarily reflect my vote in November. So I just wanted to make that firmly known so that just in case the media decides to write, well, the overwhelming support, that wasn't what we did tonight. We just passed the ordinance on to the voters. But I do have a question, not necessarily expecting an answer, but Representative Pasqualini brought up a couple of very good points. Is the verbiage has to be approved by the council. Hey, is that correct?
Could everybody please settle down just a little bit? We're almost done.
For the town clerk, the verbiage of the information as well as the referendum itself has got to be approved by the town council.
It's approved by the town council with bonding. Well, the town attorney has to approve it also, and then Secretary of State. And frankly, what I envision what Representative Pasqualini suggested, I'm not sure that we could really do that. If you had two separate plans, you know, you'd have I don't think we can have an opinion question on there. I think it would be, I'll explore it, though. I will explore it and let you know. But I've just never seen anything like that. You know, you usually have a yes. It's always it has to be a yes or a no. It's pertaining to the ordinance. So to say, are you voting no, are you voting no because it costs too much or because you don't like the plan? You know, it sounds, I don't think that I get approval on it, but I'll explore it with the Secretary of State's office because they're ultimately the ones that approve it.
Thank you. I do understand that the ordinance, the referendum has to be either a yes or no. Mm-hmm. So maybe it's more on the lines of a follow-up, more so than a 400-person statistical survey of the city and town of Groton. Thank you.
That's true. It would be a
Representative Swindell.
On the point of finding out if the ordinance is voted down. I was fortunate enough to be on the Board of Education when the very first referendum was not approved by the voters. And the board put together a survey to find out why not, a fairly thorough survey. And as a survey person myself, I can tell you that in order to do a valid survey, you don't just sort of ask whoever will answer. You have to have a random sample. So the only way to achieve what Mr. Pasqualini indicated, which I think is a good idea, basically if it does fail, is to have a real survey after the referendum has failed, if that's what happens. And like the current survey being proposed by the Economic Development Group, you need about 400 randomly selected survey participants, for it to be a valid survey with a reasonably small margin of error. So I think a survey after the referendum would be appropriate.
Representative Obrey. Yes, ma'am.
Use a microphone. Use a microphone.
Yeah. I just want to reiterate what Mark was saying earlier tonight. This celebration that we're doing down at the airport is going to be a once-in-a-lifetime celebration. It's going to be a great night. We have two blues bands that are going to be there. We've got heavy hors d'oeuvres. We've got cash bars with reasonable prices. We've got display coming from the Smithsonian Institute on pictures of the submarine history. Both the Navy and the Air Patrol are putting out demonstrations. We're going to have the Black Hawk helicopter. We're going to have a multi-million dollar aircraft that they have down there. This is all going to be in the hangar. The hangar is wide open. This, hopefully it won't rain. But, I mean, it's just going to be just a phenomenal, phenomenal night for Groton. And we need more people to come. And the 19th. You can get tickets by going on to the Mystic Chamber website, or feel free to call me, and I'll be happy to get some to you. And if you do know anybody in the service, if they're active duty, they can buy one, they'll get two, and they get free drinks. So it's really a military appreciation night. And it's really important that we all get behind this. So I'm inviting you all. Come to my house.
Thank you, Representative Obrey.
Thank you very
and,
much.
Any other business?
Yeah. What about retired military?
At this point, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move we adjourn.
All those in favor? We're adjourned. Thank you very much.